Ladies and gentlemen, Garry Moore.
Thank you very much. Thanks and welcome to another edition of To Tell the Truth. Our first guest today is one of the most accomplished makeup men in all of the history of television. To show you how fantastic he is as a makeup man, would you believe that right now you are not looking at Garry Moore? I am Raquel Welch, made up to look like Garry Moore. You don't believe that. Would you believe I'm Johnny Olson, made up to look like Garry Moore? Well, in any event, the gentleman who is going to be our first contestant is responsible for the way that hundreds of famous people look on television, including the President of the United States. And we'll meet him as soon as we've said hello to our panel, right here on To Tell the Truth.
Bill Cullen. Peggy Cass. Orson Bean. And Kitty Carlisle.
Hi, panel. How are you? Happy Monday and all like that.
Yeah, thank you.
Our first subject today is makeup. Bill, I know for sure. You don't wear any makeup on TV, do you?
No, nothing helps. nothing helps.
And Orson, I don't believe you do either.
No, as the winter goes on, I start to get as green as a pool table, and I should wear makeup on the street with maybe a little beauty mark over here, a powdered wig.
This is the only show I know where the guys don't wear makeup. I used to, years ago.
Yeah.
I finally gave up. I figure I've been around so long, who am I fooling? You know? All right, let us meet our fantastic TV makeup man.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name, Ray Voci.
Number two.
My name is Ray Voci.
Number three.
My name is Ray Voci.
All right, now all three of these gentlemen claim to be Ray Voci. Listen to the story. I, Ray Voci, am a television makeup man, and at one time or another, I have done makeup for Kitty Carlisle, Orson Bean, Peggy Cass, and Garry Moore. I also make up the guests on The Tonight Show. And in 1967, I applied powder and paint to one of that show's most illustrious guests, Richard M. Nixon. He liked what I did. He asked me to work for him during the campaign, which resulted in his election to the presidency. I am still on call. Whenever the president has a major television appearance, I fly down to Washington to help him put his best face forward. I have not only met future presidents on The Tonight Show, I have done makeup for some of the most glamorous figures in the world of entertainment, such as Della Reese, Dionne Warwick, and Ella Fitzgerald. Because of this, I have recently written a highly specialized makeup book. It is called Beauty Secrets for the Black Woman. Signed, Ray Voci. And as our panel sits here and peers through these disguised faces, let's have an unabashed commercial or two. Oh, hi there. Now, let's keep in mind that all three of these gentlemen claim to be Ray Voci, makeup man for President Nixon and other people. Let's start the questioning with the makeup man's dream, Kitty Carlisle.
With pleasure. Number two, I don't think one is saying anything disrespectful by saying that Mr. Nixon, it was said, lost the presidency the first time because he didn't photograph on television. What changes did you make for the campaign?
Mostly I cut down.
Cut down what?
I cut down on the amount of makeup.
Oh, you use less?
I use less.
And let his own bare face hang out?
Can't answer that.
Elegantly expressed.
Number three, what's the most difficult job you ever did?
I think Ella Fitzgerald was probably the most difficult.
And how long did that take?
About 35 minutes.
That's not very long.
No.
Number one, what secrets would you say, or what differences are there for the black woman than there would be for the white woman in makeup?
Finding the right color to use.
Uh-huh. And what else?
Thank you, Kitty. Let's go to Bill Cullen.
Number one, I'm going to ask the question Kitty asked of someone else. What was the most difficult job of makeup you ever did, sir?
A month ago, makeup Johnny Carson looked 75-year-old.
Other than theatrical, other than character makeup, number one. Just a person you had to make up to look like they should look.
I don't know. I can't think of anyone.
Number three, why is it that some men, and Garry and Orson and I obviously are three of them, at least we believe we are, why is it that some men can appear before television cameras without makeup and others couldn't possibly?
It has to do with the tone of the color of your skin. I think in the winter most men need a little makeup, just a touch.
The color of your skin is so beautiful.
I don't look so good then, number three.
You look lovely.
Thank you very much. Speaking of the tone or the color of the skin, it's usually expressed in numbers as far as the makeup, the base makeup you use. What color am I now, for instance, number two?
Well, you're asking for it, buddy.
Yeah.
You're about, Dave, say a C9, I would say.
C9. What?
That's known as puce.
Puce, yes.
From puce Bill, we go to Peggy, please.
Number one, could you tell me some of the famous makeup men that do real character work, like, you know, outside of yourself, of course, who make people, like, look 80 or take...
I would say you have two top men, one Dick Smith, other Barbara Bradovich.
Thank you very much. Number three, what are Nixon's problems, makeup-wise?
Well, actually, they're rather minor. He has a notoriously heavy beard, which we just lighten and tone down a bit.
Well, I don't want to hurt your feelings, but doesn't he sort of have chuckle chops here?
What?
It's the beard that...
chuckle chops, you know those
little...
Well,
the beard accentuates it, actually. We tone down the beard, that tends to disappear a bit.
Well, thank you. Number two, do you use any shading on Mr. Nixon at all?
Yes.
Where?
Eyes.
You shade his eyes? Why, does he have bags under his eyes?
Lighten his eyes.
If he's got chuckle chops, what do you call under the eyes? Bags. Laugh lumps is a better word. Let's go to Orson.
He doesn't have bags under his eyes. He's got those eyes that peer out from under that brow, that kind of a malevolent look. I'm not speaking editorially, but just in terms of makeup.
Oh,
am I? Number two, what's your stand on the new thing of men wearing street makeup?
I think sometimes it's proper.
Yeah?
Makes a man look better.
I thought when I got my electric toothbrush, I thought the world was going to hell, but now that I'm wearing makeup in the street. Number one, do you have any feelings on the new business of men wearing false hair, using moisturizing things and everything, or what?
I think the false hair is nice for weekend, want to be weekend hippie, put on beard, mustache, look fine.
Yeah? Do you ever wear any false hair, number one?
Right now I wear
false hair.
Oh, I see.
He sounds like a relative of Bela Lugosi, doesn't he? In any event, we've had all the questioning time we're allowed, so we must now vote. I hope that our votes will not be disguised. We cast them for number one, or for number two, or for number three. $50 is the price for each wrong vote, $500 if none of the votes is right, and Kitty must start.
Oh. Well, I have no idea. The makeup is fantastic, and I'm voting for number two.
Just on a hunch, eh? Yeah. All right, there's one for two, and we go to Bill Cullen.
Well, even though I don't wear makeup, I'm sure I bumped into this gentleman in the halls and around the place. I was going to vote for number one because that's not his nose. And I figured, I hope it's not his nose.
You're going to be awful embarrassed when this is
over. Yeah, I withdraw my... Anyway, I ended up by voting for number three. I don't know why, I just voted for him.
All right, there's one for two and one for three, and how about Peggy?
Oh, it just couldn't be three, absolutely not. The voice is wrong. It's either one or two, they could both be it. But number one did such a wonderful makeup job looking like Rasputin that I voted for him. He looked just like the Mad Monk.
Okay, when you say the voice is wrong, Peggy, you mean because it doesn't sound like the Ray Voci that you...
Well, the voice doesn't sound like anybody's ever made me up on number three.
Ah, I see, you're working on memory. Okay, let's go to Orson, please, for the final vote.
Number one has the great Rasputin makeup, but that cheap, low, vaudeville Russian accent has to belong to... I think it must be Henry Morgan or something. I voted for number two.
You voted for number two, all right. You say it must be Henry Morgan or something. You get the feeling that it's somebody you might know?
Henry Morgan?
Do you get the feeling that somebody, you got somebody over there you might know?
Yes.
Well, let's find out about all this. We've had all the votes are in. Well, the real Ray Voci, please stand up. There you go. Nifty job, Ray. We'll be back to you. Now, number two, who got two wrong votes. What is your real name, please, sir, and what do you do?
I'm your director of this show. My name's Paul Alter.
Paul Alter! Isn't that a great makeup job,
too? You look like
a
signer of the Declaration of Independence.
He looks better than he's ever looked.
Now, number three, Peggy...
I can't believe it now, after he tells it.
Well, we're going to bring him back with his real face in a little later on. But, Peggy, you said that number three, the voice was wrong?
Yeah.
Number three, sir, what is your real name, please, and what do you do?
My name is Peggy Parker, and I'm Mark Goodson's secretary.
Secretary to Mark Goodson of Goodson Todman Productions. Nifty job, everybody.
We thought you were a sissy.
I thought it was a sequin thief from Fire Island.
I thought that that's you were a big sissy.
Well, Peggy is coming back a little later in the show with her real face, and so will Paul. By the way, Paul's makeup and Peggy's makeup were done by the CBS staff, and we're quite proud of those makeup jobs. They're really, really good. Ray, you said that you do President Nixon. Have you ever done Mr. Agnew?
Yes, I have.
What, any particular problems there?
No, he usually has a pretty good coloring, usually a nice suntan, so it doesn't take very much.
Mm. I never, frankly, really understood the use of makeup for straight faces, you know.
Well, the main thing on men is to get rid of any beard line that might show the camera would pick up.
Mm. Because, you know, I think it's the lines in your face that show people what you've been thinking about and where you've been. Mm-hmm. If you make us all look like choir boys,
right.
You lose the character, you know. Well, Ray, thank you very much.
You'll never look like a choir boy.
I guarantee never have been.
Gary, a short thing.
Yes, Paul Alder, our director.
I would just like to thank Frank Flannery, who is directing the show for us today, while I'm out here making a fool of myself, that's all. And also, I'll be going back into the control room now.
All right, Frank and Peggy, we'll excuse you. Ray and Peggy and Paul, you go back to the control room and take over for the rest of the show. Good fun stuff. I'll be with you in a minute. You know something? Paul loves it. You're never going to get him out of that. By way of introducing our next guest, this is just a small display of some of his correspondence. And these letters are from servicemen all over the world, and they were written to one particular person. And that one particular person is not a girl. So we'll meet the young fellow who stimulated this flow of mail right after we hear some messages.
First time in.
Hey there, now let's meet the fellow who keeps those cards and letters coming in.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Charlie Hurst.
Number two.
My name is Charlie Hurst.
Number three.
My name is Charlie Hurst.
All right, now here's Charlie Hurst's story. Lend an ear. I, Charlie Hurst, probably write more letters than any boy my age. And I don't even know the people I'm writing to. You see, they're all United States servicemen, usually stationed overseas. I figured that our fighting men would really like to hear from somebody in the States, whether they know them or not. So I get different soldiers' names out of the newspapers. I sit down and dash them off a letter. Sometimes my dad has mailed as many as 12 a day. By now, I must have written to over 100 servicemen. I get lots of replies, too. Some of the men tell me I'm their only contact in the whole United States. Although I usually write to enlisted men, every once in a while I'll even write to a general. I figure that's only fair. And besides, I hope to be a general someday. Signed, Charlie Hurst. Okay, and we'll go to a lady who believes that the pen is always mightier than the sword, Peggy Cass.
Thank you. Number three, did the general answer?
Yes.
Did you write to the enemy to see now? Did you keep up a correspondence with him?
Yes.
Where is he stationed?
Fort Benning.
Thank you. Number one, do you write to soldiers like in Vietnam, too, in Cambodia?
Yes, ma'am. I write to any in Cambodia.
But in Vietnam you do.
Yes, ma'am.
And number two, in Germany? I mean, all over the world are just special places.
I haven't written to Germany, but I mostly write to people that, I mean, in from the U.S.
But, I mean, some of them are stationed in Germany.
Yeah, well, I don't know that, really.
Oh, I see. Number three, how do you get their names out of the paper?
Well, you see, I live in DeLand, Florida, and the DeLand Sun, you see, they just have the names of the people in the newspaper, Sometimes I call him up in the phone book. I find their names and I call them up in the phone book. And then I ask them, you know, the people, you know.
I see. Well, number...
Yeah, you understand that? Let's go to Orson.
Thank you. And I want to pin something down. Number one, it sounds to me, statistically, as if you could run up about $3 a week in stamps. Who pays for that, you or your old man?
Well, me and my father and my mother pays for it.
You all kind of split it up?
Yeah.
Number two, do you agree with that, what one said? Do you pay for some of the stamps or all of them? Or?
No, I only pay for some of them.
How do you make the money?
Well, allowance? I sing in a choir.
You sing in a choir, you get paid for that?
Yeah.
Hey, that's great. Number three, do you ever get writer's cramp?
Well, my mother, she has a typewriter, and sometimes she I dictate the letters to her.
Oh, great. Number one, do you do the same thing?
No, sir.
What do you do?
I write it with a pencil.
What kind of a... just a pencil? Number two?
Thank you, Orson. That takes us to Kitty.
Number two, what do you say to these fellas in general?
Well, I tell them how we're doing and what the weather is and, you know, like who's winning and in basketball and things like that.
I see. Number three, where do the letters come from that say that you're really their only contact with the people in the States?
Oh, could you restate the question? I don't really know what you mean.
Huh?
Could you restate the question?
Oh, I mean, where do the letters... what soldiers, where are they stationed when they write you and say that you're their only contact with the United States?
Well, some of them are stationed in Vietnam and at Pensacola. Naval base in Florida.
I see. Number one, how did this start?
Well, I started writing to my brother first and then...
And where was he?
Fort Jackson.
I see.
Thank you, Kitty, and that brings us to Bill.
Number two, we've determined that number three sometimes dictates to his mother at the typewriter, and number two uses a pencil, and number one uses a pencil. Number two, how do you go about physically writing these letters?
With a pencil or a pen.
Number one, do you really enjoy writing letters? I mean, not the enjoy the good you're doing. We know you're doing a great deal of good. But do you enjoy letter writing, number one?
Yes, sir.
Number three, do you write to other people besides servicemen? Do you have a normal correspondence that you keep up with fellows your own age here in the States?
Well, not usually, because I think I get a lot of fun doing it to the soldiers. And then they send me souvenirs like Vietnamese hats or pictures or maybe even medals, but, you know, that they got or something.
Number two, how old are you?
All right, that's all the time the bell rang and time to save us him having to reveal his advanced age. It's time for us to vote. And we vote for number one, or we vote for two, or we vote for three. $50 for each wrong vote, $500 if none of the votes is correct. And Peggy Cass starts, please.
Well, number three knows an awful lot about DeLand, Florida, and Pensacola. And number two looks like a choir boy. But I think it's number one. He's very serious about it.
Okay, it's one for one. And Orson, do you agree?
I voted for number two. He has the look of the budding American businessman who's going to go on to become a millionaire as a result of his... can you let me have a buck, number two?
What? A real correspondent school. Kitty?
Well, I think they're all lovely, and number one could easily be the one. Number two does look like a choir boy. But number three in the affidavit says that he wants to be a general someday. So I voted for number three because looks to me like he's dressed as though he's... getting ready to be in the military service.
Well, the votes are spread out all over the place. Bill, you're going to have to break the tie.
That's a good point. Well, I could win along on the basis that he wants to be a general someday, too. And number two looks like, to me, not the way he's dressed, but he looks like a future West Point appointee. And for that reason, I voted for number two. He also looks rich, as Orson said.
Okay. The die is cast. Will the real Charlie Hurst please stand up? Here you came in. Thank you, Charlie. Let's find out about number two, who got two wrong votes. What is your real name, please, and what do you do?
My name is Britt Byrne. I'm a student of the Alexander Robertson School in New York City.
And number three, you got one wrong vote. What is your real name, please?
My name is Ed Reef, and I'm a student at Terriville School in Long Island.
Charlie, congratulations from all of us. Let's establish what is your real age, the real one. How old are you, Charlie?
I'm 11.
You're 11 years old, huh? And you're from where?
I'm from Hiawassee, Virginia.
Good deal. Look, let me ask you one question. When you're away from home, do you write to your parents?
Sometimes.
I doubt it. Thank you very much, Charlie Hurst and friends, for being here with us on To Tell the Truth. Now, in the first spot of today's show, we had the three people from the makeup spot. Ray Voci. I think you ought to see Ray first. He is the makeup man. Let's find out what Ray really looks like. Oh. Here's Ray Voci. There you go. That's good. Now then, you saw Paul Alter. He was the fellow with the beard and the little glasses, who's our director. This is what Paul really looks like. All scrubbed up. Were you nervous as a contestant?
The worst part was going in there. The beard got in all the controls.
I can believe it.
I couldn't do the show.
Huh? Well, you did the second half, all right. And this is the one that'll really kill you. Remember the fellow on the end with the beard? With the little cap from the motorcycle school or whatever? Here is Peggy Parker. She was afraid this was going to cost her boyfriends. I have a note here that says, "Dearest Peggy, maybe the beard may lose you a few boyfriends, but you'll always have me." Signed fondly, Johnny Olson. Ray, Paul, Peggy, thank you. Now, see you tomorrow, everybody. Take care.
Promotional consideration provided by American Airlines. Traveling on business or traveling for fun, it's good to know you're on American Airlines. This is Johnny Olson speaking for To Tell the Truth, a Mark Goodson, Bill Totman production.